Welcome back, everyone. This is our fourth video for Chapter 2, and we are going to finish up our discussion on plate tectonics with this video. So if you look at where the lithospheric plates are today and where they will be in the future, geologists have actually extrapolated information to show what the future holds for our lithospheric plates and our continents. As an example, Baja California in Southern California will eventually slide past the North American plate, and Africa will continue to collide with Eurasia, pushing up the Alps even further. So this whole process, this whole chapter on plate tectonics, took 50 years to become accepted. So what is the supporting evidence that developed over these 50 years to support plate tectonics? First of all, evidence from ocean drilling. Many holes were drilled through layers of sediment that cover the ocean floor. And what was discovered from these borings were that sediments get older away from mid-ocean ridges, and sediments are very thin or absent near the ridge and thicken as you progress away from the ridge on either side. Let's take a look at this in an image. Here is your mid-ocean ridge, and the thicknesses of the borings that were done are shown in these bars, and you can see a progression of thicker sediment away from the ridge on either side, as well as older rocks as you progress away from the ridge. So this supports seafloor spreading. You wouldn't expect a thick deposit of sediment along new ocean crusts. As the plate progresses away from the ridge, then time allows for great accumulations of sediment. This is a picture of a drilling ship that can drill more than 4 miles into the seafloor. This is additional evidence in support of plate tectonics. More evidence in support of plate tectonics include the study of hot spots. A mantle plume is an upwelling of magma from deep within the earth, and they manifest themselves at the earth's surface in what we call hot spots. So let's take a look at the track of some islands that have been formed as a result of this massive outpouring of magma. And we're going to look at the Hawaiian Island Chain and Yellowstone. Here's the Hawaiian Island Chain. Kauai, 3.8 to 5.6 million years old, compared to Hawaii, which is sitting on the mantle plume, the hotspot today. So the concept, the idea is that hot spots don't move, but the lithospheric plates move over the top. And as a result, you get a series of islands popping up. So if we take the oldest of the Hawaiian chain, Kauai, and we backtrack it to the hot spot, because keep in mind, it hasn't moved, that means that the general trend of the plate, the Pacific plate, has been to the northwest direction. And here it is shown on the globe. Another set of volcanic islands, the Emperor Seamount Chain, was formed from the same hotspot. So 48 to 80 million years ago, these seamounts, volcanic islands, were moving over the hot spot here, now that where Hawaii sits today. So back in 48 to 88 million years ago, the lithospheric plate was not moving in a northwesterly direction, but actually in more of a north direction. This is a picture of hot spots and the general trend of movement. So the red spots are the hot spots, and then the trend where the plates are moving. So Yellowstone hot spot here, the North American plate has moved toward the west southwest. Hawaii, you can see, moving to the northwest. Additional evidence with plate tectonics for plate tectonics model is paleomagnetism. Remember, paleo means ancient. So this branch of science studies ancient magnetism of rocks. When ocean crust forms along our mid-ocean ridges, remember that the rock type is a basalt, and basalt contains magnetite, an iron-rich mineral. So when the basalt cools below the Curie point, that iron-rich mineral becomes magnetized and aligns itself with the Earth's existing magnetic field. And it locks in and records the magnetism. Having said that, magnetic reversals on Earth have occurred many times in the past. That means that north becomes south and south becomes north. How this process occurs is not clear. There are many different ideas. So during a magnetic reversal, what happens is the field simply reverses itself. We exist in what is called a normal polarity today. That is, the field lines leave the South Pole, go around the outside of the Earth, and re-enter at the North Pole. In times of reversed polarity, then the magnetic field lines come out of the North and go down into the South Pole and re-enter. Here we have an image showing evidence of magnetic reversals. So we have three borings here. Somebody drilled into this volcano, extracted samples. Let's start here. And the age was determined of this lava to be 2.6 million years old. And having measured its magnetic properties, it was determined that it was in a period of normal polarity, as represented by this little white portion. If we look at this lava flow, and it was analyzed, it was dated at 1.2 million years old, and it was in a time of reverse polarity. And then once again, looking at this sample, we're in a period of normal polarity. So there have been many magnetic reversals in Earth's past. This is showing a mid-ocean ridge, and this boat here is dragging an instrument to record the magnetic properties of the ocean crust. And where magnetism is high, it represents a period of normal polarity, as represented by the white streaks. Where magnetism is recorded as being weak, that indicates a period of reverse polarity, shown as these red stripes. And what comes to light from these studies is that there is a mirror image on either side of the ridge. This supports seafloor spreading. This is a close-up of the Juan de Fuca Ridge running through here, and how the white areas are normal polarity, red areas reversed polarity. So you can see it many times in the past, Earth's magnetic field has reversed itself. Another image just showing the same process of magnetic reversal as the seafloor spreads apart, and the mirrored image on either side of a ridge. So from data collected from the ocean floor, what has developed is a map that shows the age of the ocean floors here. The oranges and yellows and reds being young in age compared to the blues and purples. And once again, if you follow through a mid-ocean ridge, you would expect that to be the youngest, because that's where the new ocean crust is currently forming. So plate motion can be measured using GPS, and it is quite accurate. And the red arrows shown on the map indicate the direction and speed that the plates are moving. A high rate of speed for a plate is 15.6 centimeters per year. And a good example is your Nazca plate subducting beneath South America, forming the Andes Mountains. So in concluding here, let's talk about what drives the lithospheric plates. And it is convection in the mantle. Everyone seems to agree on that. And so we can look at a couple different ideas called slab pull and ridge push. Slab pull refers to the subduction of cold, dense ocean lithosphere. Ridge push is the idea that due to the elevated nature of mid-ocean ridges, they are being pulled or pushed by gravity. So just if you're unfamiliar with convection, it's a type of heat transfer that involves the movement of a substance. A pot of boiling water is a good example of convection. Here is an image showing the ridge push that's gravity driven, and then the slab pull results from the sinking of the cold, dense slab of oceanic lithosphere. And it's a major driving force of plate motion. So this concludes the video series for Chapter 2, Plate Tectonics.